Everyone, thanks for tuning in. Today we want to discuss the new NXP i.MX 95, and we have Manish for that on this side to discuss this new SoC and what's in there. And if you are interested in trying it out, we'll point you to the Toradex EVK, which is a new kit for testing that i.MX 95 and getting started with your projects. We'll point you to some resource there to that Verdin EVK from Toradex. But in the meantime, what we want to do is discuss the new AI capabilities of this SoC, the security aspects of it, the safety aspects of it. And for that, Manish, you are the right person. But Manish, who are you? How about you introduce yourself real quick?
I'm Manish Bajaj, based in Austin. I'm a system and architecture engineer. I lead i.MX 95, also lead AIML and ISP team within the organization.
Great, Manish. So you're the right person to tell us about this new i.MX 95 SoC. So it's coined as a new generation SoC. I'm curious to know, you know, what are the motivation? What were the motivations? How would you describe also this i.MX 95 for an embedded developer, for someone who has not read the news about it? What is your own description, and what are the main use cases to expect to be used for this SoC?
I think this is a perfect SoC for a secure, safe, connected edge device. It's a multimedia rich SoC along with all the right knobs for a machine vision use case. It has integrated NPU, which allows to run an ML inferencing on the edge itself instead of going to the cloud to perform the inferencing. It caters to multiple applications. You can use it for an infotainment for the auto world. It can be used in the surround view, DMS. For the IoT, you can use it for the home automation, security panel, security hub, even for drones. So the application is enormous, and I think the capability which it comes along with it provides a good opportunity to support multiple applications for both machine vision and for the connectivity use cases.
It actually has some hefty hardware specification, right? 6 ARM Cortex A55 cores. It has the ARM Mali GPU for advanced graphics. It has the EIQ Neutron NPU. You just mentioned that for accelerating ML models. It also has Edgelock Secure Enclave for security. We'll talk about that as well. But with such FT hardware specifications, you mentioned, you know, some of the use cases. Is it fair to say it's the SoC for running AI at the edge, whether it's generative AI or vision AI? Would you actually say that it's the right SoC if you want to build an embedded device that can deal with video sources, audio sources, with very powerful edge compute?
Exactly. I think it has all the right knobs, and especially for machine vision and the related application, it has a lot of right IPs to help execute those tasks. It has its own inbuilt ISP, along with it has encoding and decoding capability of H.264 and H.265, which can support up to 4K P60. It's the first NXP SoC which has an ARM Mali GPU, which is very powerful, which uses and utilizes the existing ecosystem to build an application. And on top of it, it has its NXP's its own NPU, Neutron IP in this, which is pretty powerful and nicely integrated with the SoC. So, and to provide more details on the NXP NPU, which is a neural processing unit on i.MX 95, one key idea behind to use NXP's own NPU and to venture to that path was to have a scalability. So now we have this NPU architecture which can be integrated to the MCU class, to a high-end MPU class of the product. It's pretty scalable, and it really provides the performance one need in running on the edge.
Got it. So you mentioned the ISP. So what is it in? It's new, right, on the SoC family. And can you tell me a little bit more about the ISP?
This would be our second SoC, which would have an inbuilt ISP. The SoC which we had was on HM Plus. It was using an external ISP. This would be the first SoC which would be using NXP's own ISP. And it's pretty powerful from its performance perspective, both from the hardware perspective and from the software ecosystem. It has some key enhancement which were not there in the previous SoC. One of the enhancement is that it supports RGB IR. And especially as I mentioned about the machine vision use case, it works in the RGB spectrum, but then there are the cases when it needs to run in the environment which is not easy to be running on the color spectrum. So having a support of IR gives an added flexibility to give the complete ecosystem and allows customer to create their application, which is more versatile.
So I wanted to go back a little bit to the NPU performance. If I remember correctly, the 8M Plus was already, in terms of ML acceleration, specified for two TOPS. And it seems the 95 is the same. So there's no improvement on the NPU, or how is it improving compared to the 8M Plus?
It's a very good question. And I know personally, I'm not a big fan of TOPS. I'm not saying that it's not a critical component of NPU, neural processing unit, but that's not the only thing which one need to consider. And I will go into details of what I'm trying to explain here. So yes, you are correct. And just a small correction there, ATEM Plus is 2.3 TOPS, and 95 is
more.
and 95 is 2.0 TOPS. But as I said, I am not really a big fan of TOPS. It is a critical component, but what TOPS provide you is a processing power of performing and inferencing. But that's not the only thing which gives you the whole performance of the system. Some of the other critical things which need to be considered is how much internal memory it has. Along with it, how well it is integrated with the DDR and to its internal memory. How well it is architected so as the transaction between the DDR and to the internal memory is minimal. How well you can utilize the data which is already available in the internal memory to be processed. So yes, processing unit which the TOPS provide is an important part. But the second important part and the rest of the things is how well it is integrated, how much internal memory you have in the NPU, along with it, how well you can reuse the data which is already there in the internal memory to perform the processing. So just to now come back to 2.3 TOPS, which we have on 8M Plus, to 2 TOPS, which we have on 95, to give a small benchmark number on a commonly used model, say MobileNet V1, we are seeing a performance of around 350 inferencing per second on 8M Plus, and on 95, we are seeing more than 1,000 inferencing per second. MobileNet SSD, which is a detection model, which is slightly heavier, and it needs to do some more processing. On 8M Plus, it's around 130 inferencing per second. And on 95, we are seeing upward of 500 inferencing per second. So that's what I mean to say, that TOPS is a critical part of it, but then it's just not the only part which defines how well an NPU would really execute and perform the inferencing. And it's an inferencing which runs on the edge without going to the cloud and provides a pretty good performance.
That makes sense. There goes your TOPS. But I think I like the way you are saying that it's not just about the TOPS. It's also about the data pipeline, right? How you deal with the data ahead of the processing. And as a matter of fact, there's an ingestion consideration as well. The data is coming from peripherals, from hardware. What's new? What is to be highlighted? What do customer need to realize when it comes to the i.MX 95 in terms of connectivity, in terms of input types? Is there something new, something you want to discuss here?
I think it's another key point and key differentiator on i.MX 95. We have MIPCSI to feed in the camera input. We have two of those, and both of the MIPCSI can support a virtual channel. Each can support up to 8 virtual channel, and even the data rate which it supports is much higher than what we have ever supported on any of the previous i.MX device. It's 2.5 gigabits per second as compared to we used to support 1.5 gigabits per second. Along with that, it also has a high processing, high performing PCI. We have two of these. Both can support Gen 3. Along with that, we have a three Ethernet port. One Ethernet can support up to 10 gigabits. So yes, there are multiple high performing interfaces which allows a good way of inputting a data to the system, process it within the system, do the pre-processing using the GPU or the 2D engine, do the business logic with the NPU or the ARM core, and then again feed it out through the network or the PCI.
So now we're bringing more intelligence to deal with more data at the edge. There's a consideration that everyone is concerned about, which is security. And the i.MX 95 sports an Edgelock secure enclave. And that's something which is key to making sure not just the data, but also the IP you put on that device, which is the ML model, is secure, is safe, right? So can you tell me a bit more about how secure is the i.MX 95 and how do you at NXP approach that level of security?
I will discuss about the Edgelock, which is an independent security domain block within the SoC, but you brought up a very important point and I would like to touch base on that. How would you secure inferencing or what is happening within the system so that if you are doing any, and specific to the ML inferencing again, if you have some model in your system and how would you make sure that nobody is stealing that data from you or not nobody is stealing the model and then altering the inferencing result for you? So the DDR transaction, which happens from the DDR to the NPUs are secure. The DDR line, the way we have designed this one in 95 is that the transaction happening between the system would be secure. So that adds an added security, which avoids somebody to tamper the data which flows between the one IP to another. So a very good point you brought it up. But coming back to the, coming back to the Edgelock enclave, as I was mentioning, it's an independent security domain that provides security services, which includes key management and executions of cryptographic services. So what it means is that this independent security domain provides a secure environment which enables application to execute their secure cryptographic services. It natively supports a TRNG, which is a true random number. This can be a source to an entropy that can be used to generate a random number for use in the cryptographic algorithms. It also have a key management support along with all the fuse management is also supported by the Edgelock enclave.
Awesome. Yeah, that makes sense. I will definitely invite people watching to go learn more about the notion of secure enclave in general. I think it's underused, something that people don't really understand yet. But with AI coming to the edge, you know, that strong, and the i.MX 95, I'm sure will help multiply the number of projects running AI at the edge. I think people will realize the importance of secure enclaves like the Edgelock. So I think it's a really good addition here. Another thing that struck me when reading about the i.MX 95 is the claim that safety was baked into the design of the i.MX 95 with the mention of a real-time safety domain. And so what is it exactly? I was assuming when reading that it was about the fact that these embedded devices at the edge, they need to react and you need to have some level of confidence on how fast, not just how fast, but how they will be deterministic in responding to specific conditions to act, right? Stopping a robot arm if a safety limit has been reached, detected on a video feed. Am I in the right area of discussion here? What is safety by design for i.MX 95?
Brought up a very good question and point here. So i.MX 95, along with all the multimedia and NPU PIF and the security, which is pretty cutting edge, one of the key differentiator on 95, which we did not had in any of the previous i.MX, was to have a safety capability And just to maybe peel off the onion here, what we are seeing is that now safety has become, and it used to be an integral part of an automotive and even on industrial segment. We are seeing that getting penetrated even to the consumer market also, especially since we have now robots which are being planned to be developed in the home environment, along with all the other drones activities happening or the applications happening on that domain. Safety has become a key critical component, not only on the high-end automobile business, but even on the IoT side of the world. So, and that's where I think i.MX 95 is a key differentiator, where it has an independent real-time processing unit, which allows to run its secure or the safe application on the real-time part of the module, whereas the high-end application can run on its own application domain. What it allows is that it allows the safe application to run reliably, independently, and without getting interrupted by the rest of the application. So it is a deterministic application where it can announce what failure it's happening. So it gives a separate independent visibility of running a safe application outside of the other high machine vision use case or HMI application running on the automotive or industrial or even in the IoT spectrum.
Yeah. Now we see more and more embedded in IoT devices having an interface, a user interface with graphics, hence the GPU, by the way. We didn't mention much about it, but we really wanted to focus on the embedded development aspects of things here. So brilliant. I like that. I think embedded developers, especially the ones who have been dealing with real-time systems in, you know, automotive, industrial automation and others, will appreciate that very much, because determinism is something that is super important and key, and you cannot give up, you know, processing to the edge. You cannot give up on the safety of your application that needs to have determinism in there. So all of that processing, GPU, NPU, and well, all of that must consume some energy. And once again, we're talking about embedded devices, might be in an enclosure, in a in an environment that is not really, you know, I would say friendly. So all of that to me, you know, rings like, hey, there's going to be a lot of energy consumed. It's going to release a lot of heat. You know, so. And that's something that's not something you want on the embedded at the edge world, right? So tell me some about this notion of energy consumption. How good is the i.MX 95 in terms of energy consumption optimization?
Again, a very good question here. So what we are talking about here is a SoC which has 6 A55 core, 1 M7, 1 M33, along with it has a independent security block, and powerful NPU, 3D GPU. It can support 3 display at the same time, along with it has a ISP performing an camera processing on the SoC itself. So yes, it's a pretty powerful SoC. But along with that, it comes with the flex architecture, which started with i.MX 9. The first SoC was i.MX 93, and now the next SoC is i.MX 95. What it allows you is to power gate the component or the module which is not currently active. Now, let's take an example here. You have a case where you are doing some machine vision use case and you want to display it at some point of time, but you don't want to use the display at every time when you're running it. So there is a knobs provided where you can power gate that whole block. So what we have done is that we have divided key IPs into its own module. You can call it a mixes. So we would have a display mix. We would have an NPU mix, which will be used for ML inferencing. Then we would have a graphics mix or GPU mix that would be encapsulated in its own module. What flex architecture allows you is that you can power gate the whole mix so that it does not consume the power and you can save energy there. Along with whenever it's needed, you can power gate. It also has a clock gating option, automatic clock gating also. So within the IP block, if certain section of the IP you are not using it, that can also be power gated or clock gated. So it has lots and lots of knobs to play with and wiggle around to provide those flexibility to the embedded engineers.
And I would assume that all of that comes with the software stacks that will allow the developer to easily control all this functionality, right?
Exactly. So one key critical functionality we are adding is a system manager. So the M33, which we have on 95, would be running a system manager, which allows all these knobs to be controlled by the application. One good thing, which is, again, I would like to highlight, since you brought up the software part of it, the whole system manager code would be available, would be openly available. Anybody can look into it and optimize it based on their need. We'll provide a reference example for the same. Along with it, one key difference here would be is that it's based on SEMI, which is a standard ARM-provided interface. So it's not something which is NXP proprietary and open standard. So a lot of flexibility, both from the hardware and the software perspective.
Awesome. And I know the partner Toradex, we're going to talk about in a second, they're all about open source, right? And so I think that goes directly into the wheelhouse of building around the SoC to provide something that developers can use to rapidly build their embedded application. So talking about that, what is your recommendation for developers, for professionals? We want to put their hands on the i.MX 95, evaluate it, and get started with it. What is your recommendation here?
First of all, I'm really excited with this opportunity or this engagement we have with Toradex. So for the engineers and the customer who would like to get started, they can sign up to the Toradex website for their own i.MX 95 Verdin EVK. The carrier board will allow them for a simple evaluation and development, and it will begin shipping starting next week from the embedded world. Along with that, as the Toradex offers this i.MX 95 Verdin board in the same form factor as the previous Verdin. So if somebody wants to develop their own carrier board or can use the same carrier board actually as the older Verdin board and can use the previous SOM maybe of i.MX 8M Plus, and when they want to switch to the newer version of 95, it becomes easier plug and play. So if somebody already is using a carrier board, which is of Verdin, they can start playing with right away itself and then easily plug and play with an i.MX 95 compute board.
Nice. Yeah. Hence the systems or modules that, use utility, I would say.
Exactly.
That's awesome. Manish, well, thanks a lot for your time today. I hope people now know more about the i.MX 95 and now they can get on Toradex website. We put the link down there for them to go get that Verdin evaluation kit and get started in their development. Thanks a lot, Manish.
Thanks for your time. Really appreciate it. Thank you.